In New York, we are extremely fortunate to have a number of exceptional historians who delve deep into archival records for the purpose of bringing history to light. One of our most prolific researchers is Scott Mingus, Sr., whose efforts resulted in 15 Civil War books. Scott also maintains an award-winning blog on the Civil War history of York County, which can be found at www.yorkblog.com/cannonball. And he does all of that in his spare time. In his day job, Scott is a scientist and an executive at Quaker, where he's been for 14 years. He holds patents in self-adhesive postage stamps, barcode labels, that's important for museums. He was part of the research team that developed the first commercially successful self-adhesive U.S. postage stamp. And aren't we all grateful for that, that we don't have to lick paper anymore. But seriously, Scott's historical writings have gained national attention. His biography of Confederate General William Extra Billy Smith won a 2013 Nathan Bedford Forrest Southern History Award, as well as the James I. Robinson Jr. Literary Prize. And he was nominated for the Virginia Literary Award for nonfiction. He has also written several articles for Gettysburg Magazine. But let me tell you, he's not resting. After 15 books, he has now embarked upon an important challenge, beginning a serious and important project researching the Underground Railroad, which for many of you all know, it's one of the most difficult episodes of history to document because of the secret. There is very little evidence. So he will share some of his findings with us today about South Central Pennsylvania and look in the future to the York County Heritage Trust as we will publish his 16th book. We're very proud to do so. It is my pleasure that we welcome Scott Mingus to the podium.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you very much for inviting me to come to talk today. Hopefully we're going to talk a little bit about the Underground Road. As Joe mentioned, this is a subject that's actually become near and dear to my heart. The more I started diving into it, the more I realized how little we really know. And so hopefully through a lot of the work we've been doing, we've uncovered a lot of new things and there's some interesting new things that'll be out of the book. For now, in the next 15, 20 minutes, I'll give you a sweeping overview of the Underground Road here in Quaker County. So everybody, please feel free to take a moment to reposition your chairs and people. Most of you are probably aware of the issue of slavery, one of the most divisive topics, of course, in American history. What people may not be aware of is that Pennsylvania was the one time one of the leading states for slavery. In fact, during the American Revolution era, through the very early 1800s, there were more slaves in Pennsylvania than in much of the Deep South. In fact, if you add up all the colonies in the Deep South, Georgia, etc., there were far more slaves in Pennsylvania at the turn of the century than there were there. Slavery in this region started in 1639, so that early start, in particular the Dutch, who were bringing slaves into this region, and Philadelphia became the hotbed where most of those slaves were coming into. At first, the Pennsylvania residents kind of tolerated slavery. A few of them embraced it. But realistically, as time went on, a certain element of Pennsylvania's population, a very important part of it, namely the Quakers, started objecting to this whole idea of buying and selling other human beings. In fact, in 1688, in Germantown, a group of Quakers started a formal petition to try to get the church to stop it. That petition did not do anything short-term, but eventually it would. But what that petition led to over the next 50 years or so was a growing opposition to slavery in Pennsylvania. And in fact, two of the leading people who became vocal in their anti-slavery adherence were John Dickinson, Dickinson College fame, of course, and Benjamin Franklin. A group of Quakers started what was called the Pennsylvania Society for the Abolition of slavery, make the name very short from what the long name is. And this became the leading anti-slavery movement in the entire country, long before Massachusetts and other states got involved. With all this protest in Pennsylvania, there were still 6,000 people who held bondage in Pennsylvania when the American Revolution ended. That's a big number when you consider that Georgia at the same time had 800. South Carolina had about 1,000. This was the third largest slave state in the country, behind only Virginia and North Carolina, at that point in time. So we never think of Pennsylvania being a slave state, but with this growing opposition to it, Pennsylvania legislature in 1780 passed what was called the Gradual Abolition Act. This would eventually, over time, eliminate slavery within the Commonwealth's borders. What it effectively said was that for 28 years, you may be born after that date, you have to serve for 28 years. But you can see what happened. Within just 10 years, slavery had dropped in half in Pennsylvania, and the number of free blacks, including ex-slaves, had dramatically increased. The first known reporting here in York County of slavery, in terms of enumerating them, was in 1783, where there were 657 slaves, the majority of which were beach people. The largest, there were a lot of rural area, a lot of people down there that needed slaves. But the courthouse, the old York County, it's not obviously the replicas of the screen, saw a number of anti-slavery meetings and anti-slavery movements here in York alone. Began by 1790, just 7 years after there were 657 slaves, in York County we're down to 77. So you can see in just a 7 year period, slavery was pretty much eradicated by and large in York County as it was dropping throughout the entire state. However, nationally there was a growing concern that because Pennsylvania in particular was now getting an anti-slavery event, was certainly now starting to have people be the main event or emancipated here in the state. A lot of Marylanders, a lot of Virginians who were slaves started looking to Pennsylvania or to places like New Jersey or to the unsettled West, what's now Ohio, for places of refuge. As they started coming across the border, Pennsylvanians were not so willing to give these people back. And they wanted to shelter them, they wanted to help them. In some cases, they put these escaped slaves to work, particularly the farms and things like that. But Pennsylvania became quite a target for a lot of these escaped slaves. We're a new country, keep in mind. This is only less than 10 years after the American Revolution, but already the North and the South are starting to bicker, some of these new states, about what is going to happen here in terms of slavery. That's particularly becomes true in the halls of Congress. Maryland, Pennsylvania, Virginia, Delaware, New Jersey, New York, Massachusetts. Those states in particular were very anxious to solve the problem, to figure out what to do. So in 1793, they passed the first federal act concerning slavery. Did not outlaw slavery, did not touch the legality of slavery. What it did talk about was the legality of helping escaped slaves. And that, in effect, in a nutshell, was a fairly weak central federal power or federal act, but it did give the federal government the right to start dictating to the individual states how slavery was going to be handled. So, in particular, one of the things that was probably the most controversial part, and it was the part that would get a lot of people in trouble, was the fact that the state where the slave had escaped to, i.e., in our case, Pennsylvania sheriffs, Pennsylvania constables, Pennsylvania judges had to be the final authority for when slaves are captured in Pennsylvania, you went to a Pennsylvania judge to at least get the legal paperwork done that would escort the slave back into Maryland or Virginia. Very controversial act. While this is going on, the Quakers have not been hired. One of the hotbeds of the Quaker movement here in York County was, of course, the Northern Tier. In particular, at this point in time, I call your attention to the Redlands area. Redlands, obviously, this year made a lot of national headlines for its Little League baseball team. Obviously, back in the 1820s, 1830s, and 1840s, it was making national headlines for other reasons. One of which was the number of anti-slavery speakers who would come into that region, in particular to Lewisburg, and would speak on the topic of abolition in that region. Again, quite the hotbed. In a particular, several Quaker families, the Harrisons, the Smiths, people along those lines, were particularly vocal in their anti-slavery actions. Where the Redlands made national headlines, unfortunately, is the next slide. In August of 1824, the first known murder of an escaped slave north of the Mason-Dixon line happens in the Redlands, right here in New York County. Joe Garrison owned a farm. It's about a mile east of Lewisbury, along Benetton. The original farmhouse is gone, but the site is still there. There are four guys named Metro from Colorado Township who are professional slave catchers. They saw an ad in the local newspaper that would reward them $20 a piece for finding these different slaves, and they went looking for them. Now, it was well known in the Redlands region that Joseph Garrison was hiding slaves. He had used them on his farm for a long time. This was not a new occurrence for Garrison or for some of the other Quakers in that region. This particular fugitive slave, we only know his name is George. He's not recorded beyond that in the court documents. But he's hiding inside Garrison's house. He's got an old stone farmhouse. He's upstairs in the garret. The slave catchers, the four of them, are down on the horses down below. And George is scared. He's terrified. Garrison's trying to stall as long as he can. The slave jumps out the window, gets badly injured, and jumps out the window, tries to run through a cornfield towards the barn, and he is shot. He's critically injured, mortally wounded. He's going to be taken down to Virginia after a very hasty surgery. His body will be put on display in Virginia as a warning to all slaves of what happens to you if you go to Pennsylvania. It was a brutal, brutal example. The abolitionists of Massachusetts in particular made this into a national crusade. If you read the newspapers nationally from 1824, 1825, even as late as 1830, they're still using this as a firebrand for their cause. So abolitionists throughout the country are now realizing just how horrific this whole fugitive slave act is. And people like William Lloyd Garrison, Frederick Douglass, a lot of these other abolitionist leaders now start calling for the immediate end of slavery, the immediate emancipation of everybody in bondage in the entire country, not just in Pennsylvania. So this elevated from a, what do we do with these fugitive slaves, into a, what do we do with the whole premise of slavery as a whole. When 1832, it really comes to a head, and again, Moore County is at the forefront. A young slave woman by the name of Margaret Morgan has married a man with York County roots by the name of Jerry Morgan. They moved into First Lower Chancellor Township, and actually first in the Fawn and then later in the Lower Chancellor Township. Well, her owner had never freed her. She, by Maryland law, was considered to be still a slave. So Mrs. Morgan raises a family here in Pennsylvania. She has children that are born on both sides of the border. Her master dies in a very, very business-savvy and, shall we say, aggressive son-in-law by the name of Andrew Bemis. Convinces the widow that we need to collect all the slaves that we can that belong, and we need to sell them. We need the money. So Nathan Bemis convinces Margaret Ashmore, the widow who now owns Margaret Morgan, that I need these slaves back. Her good friend, Edward Prigg, is an attorney in Baltimore County. Prigg and Bemis come into York County, follow the legally prescribed system of finding a local constable, finding a local judge, present the paperwork that allegedly proves that American Margaret Morgan is an escaped slave, she's illegally here in Pennsylvania, and they follow the written procedure almost to the T, and come and arrest Margaret Morgan and six kids. Jerry Morgan's a free name. He can produce papers and let them go. It's the wife and the six kids that are going to be the issue. So, Craig and Bemis come back to the judge. Here's where it starts getting tricky, because Pennsylvania had passed a law that local justices of the peace could know while you could file paperwork for a term to at least go arrest the people. You cannot file the extradition papers with a local gendarme or with a local judge, justice of the peace. It had to be a state-appointed judge. And there were no state-appointed judges available in the middle of the night. All this, of course, is happening on a very rainy, cold January evening of February 1832. So all this is going on, and Mr. Brigg and Mr. Mingus know what to do. They do know one thing. They got to get the slave out of Pennsylvania and her kids before something happens. So they slip away the night back down to Baltimore County without the legally required by Pennsylvania law signed document from the judge here in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania reacts by immediately, within the next few days, starting to file kidnapping charges against Edward Brigg and Nathan Davis and their two other cohorts that were here with them. Pennsylvania, in absentia, finds these guys guilty. Maryland was furious over the whole issue, and they decided they're going to put this up before the Maryland state legislature. Years start passing. Jerry Morgan ends up drowning in the canal over Wrightsville. Barbara Morgan ends up being sold into slavery and disappears from history. But the legal problem continues in Maryland and Pennsylvania to the point where they finally work out a deal that we're going to let this go to the United States Supreme Court. And we're going to make this test case between Pennsylvania and Maryland the final authority on whether that fugitive slave law of 1793 still holds water. Make a long story short, Craig had been convicted here in York County. The Supreme Court overturns everything. Edward Craig is a free man, and Pennsylvania is found to be at fault. Maryland, of course, is the winner in this whole incident. The losers are the Morgans. All this legal stuff's going on. The two people who brought the whole thing on are no longer with us, unfortunately, at that point. But in reaction to this canal, Pennsylvania and most other northern states start passing personal liberty laws that say once you're on our soil, the minute a slave voluntarily or involuntarily crosses the face of Dixon line, they're free. Because anybody in Pennsylvania is free at that point in time. Well, Maryland doesn't like that, obviously, because that's going to cut down the trade because a lot of the people who were driving wagons, things like that, were slaves between Baltimore and here. Huge issue. And the North and the South continue to bicker over this Brigg deal for a number of years. This is 1842, the law is passed. It takes 8 years of fighting in the United States Congress, spearheaded by Pennsylvania and Maryland, and a few other states get involved. It's really these two states that are the crux of the whole thing that will finally get this resolved. While all of this is going on, slaves continue to pour across the border. And of course, now the issue is, how do we help them? We've already had slaves killed here in Pennsylvania. We've had slaves kidnapped and taken back. But the Quakers and others start loosely organizing into what's commonly called the Underground Railroad. And again, I use the term loosely organized. Unlike a railroad with schedules and known tracks and known destinations and known stops, the Underground Railroad comes and goes in different places. It moves around. It's very fluid. It doesn't have set pathways. Well, in most cases. Why? It's illegal. Mark my words. This is a highly illegal activity. When it's like you're breaking the laws of the United States, you're risking fines, way more jail time for helping escape slaves. That can be a big problem, of course. This Underground Railroad, the common perception of it is conductors are moving escaped slaves from spot to spot. And usually the night of this, not necessarily always true by any point in time. Here's the interesting point. Remember I said, who is responsible for those escaped slaves? It's the constables and the sheriffs of the local communities that have to make the arrests. In the case of Margaret Morgan, it was the lower Chancellor Township Constable, William McClary, who physically arrested her. That means the sheriff had to do it. Here's the problem. The main sheriff of York County, William Yoder, is an Underground Railroad conductor. That's a problem if you're from Maryland. And the sheriff becomes, because he knows his territory, becomes really, really good. Somebody from Maryland shows up here in York and says, I got this escaped slave, here's a description of him. And the sheriff says, I've heard that he was out in Thomasville. Let me take you to Thomasville while his associate slips out the back and makes sure the slave goes to Wrightsville. You know, the kind of geography. So the sheriff is sending the slave catchers with himself in escort the wrong direction to places he knows there are no escaped slaves at that point in time. It's amazing how few escaped slaves are captured in York County while William Yoder was the sheriff. He's not the only one. Now, here are the only couple scenes in the back. In red are all these routes. Ohio Native. Ohio was probably the linchpin of activity on the Underground Railroad. But here, certainly in southern Pennsylvania, was another key hub of the Underground Railroad, Lancaster, York counties. In fact, in many ways, are the epicenter of the entire Underground Railroad movement. And the big reason over here was the Susquehanna River. If you could get them across the river into the Quaker territory in Lancaster, the Quakers would make it disappear. So the fugitive slaves kind of knew this was where they had to cross. In this red area, a lot of the code names were, that was the River Jordan. So if you could get them across the River Jordan, the Susquehanna, and Quaker hands were safe. Now, in my area in southern Ohio, the Ohio River was the River Jordan. So in those cases, slaves coming up from Kentucky and Tennessee, or from what's now West Virginia, would be brought across the Ohio River. Here are some of the major routes in York County. This is certainly not exhaustive, but it gives you an idea. The key was to get them to the river. So you wanted to get them into York, into the Lewis area, where the two main traffic lines, particularly York. Well, from Lewis area from York, you fan them out across that river. Sometimes you had to send them very circuitous routes to get them across that river. And a lot of it, and let's be very honest, a lot of you probably have stories from great-great-great-grandpa about they were involved in the Underground Railroad and stuff. They probably were. I just can't prove them in the book. Because, again, most people never left written records. But as far as what we do know, as far as retracing the actual routes, this is the best we can come. Not to say that every single one of these routes is totally accurate, or to say that there weren't other routes. But these are the major routes that can get up to the river. With four major crossing points, one being in the Beachbottom area, second one being in Wrightsville, where there was a long bridge across the Susquehanna River, and next one was the Orcas, and then the final one was the Harrisburg. Whole slew of people, and I don't spend much time on this, were involved in the Underground Railroad locally. I will comment that there were three major rings, if you will, of the Underground Railroad, which may or may not have been interconnected. The first one was the Quakers. We already kind of talked about the Quaker routes. Went up through Lewisberry, went up through Dover, went through Wellsville, Warrington Township, on through Dillsburg, or up through York Haven to the river, depending on the routes. There was also a black network. Often it's overlooked in the whole Underground Railroad story how important the free blacks of the North were. Often slaves would never see a white conductor. The black network was extensive in a lot of places, and particularly here in North County, where there's a whole slew of different people were involved, starting from Samuel Martin's report all the way to William Goodrich. Goodrich himself, of course, is probably familiar to many of you through this wonderful mural that exists off of West Market Street. He owns his house at 123 East Philadelphia Street. He risked a lot of stuff to try to escape, help escape slaves to the river. And he owned railroad cars. A lot of stories were told of him putting slaves into the railroad cars, taking them out to Wrightsville, and slipping through the tunnel where they picked up and eventually taken through the Quaker network to Philadelphia. Another one, this is part of the Quaker network, probably the one place that's the most documented in the Quaker network is this home, which is off of Willis Road, just south of US Route 30, and west of George Street, on George Street. This Quaker's name was Samuel Willis. He was heavily involved as far as we can tell. And particularly a number of feeders, well, one of which was Amos Grice. There was another feeder by the name of Jonathan Jessup. You guys know where Appleville Medical Center is today? Jonathan Jessup was heavily involved in apple growing. He was also heavily involved in Underground Railroad. So right around where Appleville Medical Center was, certainly quite a lot in the Underground Railroad movement here in this area. One of the other problems for Marylanders was that there was also a German network, very small, but a German network here in York, and it's headed by Charles Barnes. Charles Barnes was the United States Congressman. That's a problem if you're trying to have slaves. First, you have the sheriff involved, now you have the local congressman involved in the Underground Railroad, who obviously is going to block things as much as he can from a legal perspective as well. He's heavily involved in moving people out to the railroad. A lot of other sites in York County won't spend much time on this as well, but I will comment that Harry Tubman, very well-known abolitionist and slave escort, if you will, who would take them out, particularly the Delmarva Peninsula, and move them into Pennsylvania. And there was active here in York County. You know, at least two visits that have been recorded over time per year of this area. So we're familiar with this house over by the hospital. Allegedly installed an underground railroad. Again, just not enough documentation to really prove it. Once again, it's in Wrightsville, the house, which was Jonathan Wright's house. Many of you have seen this lovely old farmhouse that you can see, very nice little rudder parking lot on the east side of Cool Springs Road. Jonathan Mifflin was probably the final point in Wrightsville for a lot of these slaves before they were taken across the river. And number one, we're also the African American community, and heavily involved with the local church as well. It's not a church that existed during the Underground Railroad years. Not only still after the Civil War, but it's in the same location. All this led to Congress reacting in 1850 by passing the most stringent anti-fugitive slave act in American history. By then, perhaps as many as 100,000 slaves had left, but the North and the South were frankly demonstrated at war in 1850. This was part of the overall compromise of 1850, which included the Missouri Compromise and a number of other acts. The Fugitive Slave Act, of course, is the one most heard of in Pennsylvania. But if I call down your attention to the fifth bullet point, any person, this is a direct quote from the law, any person assailing a runaway slave or providing shelter, food, or any other assistance is liable to 6 months imprisonment and $1,000 fine. Now the feds are getting involved. Now it's the United States Marshals. They're going to enforce the law with federal judges, federal courts, federal prisons. They just escalated this whole thing from the dispute between Maryland and Pennsylvania, or between Virginia and Ohio. Now it's a national issue with national punishment, national penalties, and a national crime. Again, as mentioned, the U.S. Marshals are going to enforce it. These slave catchers are now given national immunity. Just like Pennsylvania had arrested Edward Craig and had arrested Nathan Mingus, now anywhere in America a slave catcher would go, realizing he could not be charged. And these guys went everywhere. I mean, there were recorded slave catchers going all the way to Minnesota in pursuit of slaves from Missouri. Because they go anywhere they want, and some of these rewards are now starting to be quite big. And in the South, of course, they react to this whole thing by taking advantage of the fugitive slave law against them. Here's big numbers now, $200 rewards. So these have jumped in just 20 years, from $20 to $200 in an era without inflation of any substance. So now it's very lucrative. So these slave catchers are joined by amateurs who join the ranks as well. And this is things get ugly. Underground Railroad truly goes underground starting in 1850. At that point in time, in 1851, the final straw is a slave catcher shows up in Lancaster County, tries to pick off several escaped slaves that are rumored in Lancaster County. A riot ensues. The slave catcher, who happens to be the slave owner in this case, is killed. One of his sons is critically wounded. The rest of the slave catcher party are either shot or very much chased out of town. After the son of the slave catcher is brought here to downtown York to recover from his injuries. The so-called Christiana resistance, or the Christiana riot, is the final struggle at a point in time. A Quaker white man from Pennsylvania is the first person the federal government will put on trial for treason with a death penalty assigned to him, telling you how now the federal government steps up. 15 minutes of deliberation, the jury finds him not guilty. And all resistance to try to catch these folks disappears. South gets furious, North digs in its heels, and the next 9 years are going to be pure hell in the United States of America as these competing North-South interests. And yeah, we'll talk about states' rights, and we'll talk about tariffs, and we'll talk about banking. Make no mistake about it, slavery leads to the dissolution of this country. You can trace it right back to the events that start here in York County. And all the way, the Civil War is the question. Thank you. We're very close to your time and attention today. I do want to thank my brother's son, this is a